Okay, so let's begin. We have minutes to approve, and I so move we do.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, unanimous. Good work. Public hearing, we're early. Is Eversource, are you Eversource?
Yes.
Do you want to say something to us?
We should probably wait.
Oh, we have to wait officially until 3:15.
If a letter show up or something.
Never mind. Public comment. Dan, do you have anything, Dan?
Nothing.
Okay, old business.
What about Judy?
Oh, Judy, I'm sorry. But you're, aren't you on the agenda for Mass Preservation Project?
We'll talk.
We'll talk.
Maybe she had other things to say.
Maybe you did, sorry. Anybody else? My enthusiasm is overcome. So, old business, town office space.
This was on the agenda because, well, we had that brief conversation earlier this week about utilization of the rest of the town office space.
Okay, yes.
And we were wondering about an update on SCAMS, but our delegate liaison's not here at the moment, so I can tell you that the storage vault has gone out to bid. And that's, those are due back middle of, end of March. And that's for the storage vault. That was the CPA funds and the other $64,000 that were allocated for that. Bids are due March 23rd, and the bid packages are available on the Town of Whately website.
Good to know.
So I don't know if we want to have any further conversations about that, town offices.
Well, my concern is just we rent out whatever space we have that's rentable and get on with life. You know, if SCAMS is going to stay in Deerfield, then we need to get some revenue generated in this building, is my opinion.
What are we doing with remodeling the rest of the space there?
That's something we need to keep going with.
There's money remaining.
Yep.
After the vault.
Yeah, there's still money to get the partitions and the, well, not the partitions, but the 8-foot walls that we were talking about. 8-foot walls.
Well, the vault money is not coming out of that, right?
Correct. It's separate, yeah.
So you still have, other than what you've already done.
Yep.
So we've got furniture and partitions to put up.
I'm wondering if we should employ the use of a commercial real estate agent to move this space or develop specs of what's available and, you know, get more serious about this.
Yeah.
It's a shame to have all that space sitting there. And, you know, the way it looks like, Deerfield's going to do what they're going to do. SCAMS somehow. I don't know how. I haven't heard anything concrete. And there seems to be some question about their funding of it. But we're not in the loop, so we don't know. I mean, I guess Jonathan is, because he was at the meeting. But I haven't heard anything.
Sutherland just advertised for an RFP or whatever for their space. And of course, I think they've already picked the one person in it, one company that submitted a bid. Maybe you could ask them what they used to advertise.
Yeah.
If it was something useful, I don't know.
What space did they, they're renting out a space?
Yeah, where was it? No. Center of town?
That's Furcats. Not Furcats.
Furcats
going in.
Right, but where's that space now?
In their town hall.
In their town hall, okay.
That was kind of a, yes, they went out to bid because you have to go out to bid.
And all that, yeah.
But it was kind of inside job.
Look at their ad and see if we could use that.
Yeah, it'll be informative, we'll be the buyers.
We were kind of waiting for, once the vault went in, then we could see, and Brian could see, we're going to have to steal some storage space out of that space that's left. So whether we put up another secondary, another wall, so that he then has, we, the town, have storage space, say, behind the vault, and then that would give us, then we know what space we've got to lease out.
Well, we could decide on the final design of that space. We haven't really done that.
Right, well, that's kind of what we're waiting for, the vault.
Well, that space and the rest of the office space here, I guess, to see who's going where and when.
Right. I mean, we've gone through several iterations of how to break that space apart. we do need to take a look at the other side of that, the other side of the wall, and figure out how much square footage.
Yeah, we do.
Right now the garage is full with fire trucks and fire trailers and things like that. So that space is being used for heated space for you know, town vehicles, but the inside space.
So the vault, what's going on for bid? A design for the vault or construction of the vault?
Installation of the vault.
Installation. So we should know
so
how
purchase,
much
the
space
purchase installation.
Right.
Yep.
So what's I don't get what's keeping us from getting more finalized.
We can.
Yes. We should do that. That should be on our priority list. I'm sure it is.
Well,
I'm
right.
Not sure what level of priority.
Town
it should be pretty high.
Well, maybe after
town office space.
Yeah. Here, we can look at that again.
Yeah, and I'm not sure. I mean, maybe it would have been nice to have. You know, if FCAT would have been here, but on the other hand, we might do better with commercial real estate. And
I don't think they're looking for as much space as we're going to have.
Oh, okay. Well, then that's good. Okay, just my concerns.
Yeah.
We've still got 5 minutes. Town hall grant applications. We can at least talk about.
Talk about green communities.
Green communities.
Have you signed something if you're willing?
Oh, yes. I'm willing. You willing?
Yes.
Well, I think we just need one person. Paul, I think you just need the chairman to sign.
Okay.
But you guys need to authorize you to sign it. So this is for the submission of the green communities grant. That's due this Friday. And that's for the town hall. And it's for four or five energy conservation measures. One is insulation, air sealing, LED lighting, HVAC upgrades, and point of use hot water heaters.
Is that like a cover sheet or?
Is this?
Yeah.
Certificate.
This is the authorization to file.
Okay.
I'm the chief executive officer.
What's the grant amount we're applying for?
Just so you know.
we don't know exactly, but it's going to be somewhere in the range of probably $200,000. I mean, it really depends on what the engineer comes back with and we can justify in terms of the green communities for cost savings.
Okay.
For the upgrades, because really what they look at is the payback.
Oh, sure.
They want to help towns purchase and install equipment that's going to pay back within the useful life of the equipment.
They use a simple payback calculation.
Okay. I believe so, yeah.
Well, specific to each item.
Yeah. Yeah, so the lights cost X, they'll save X per year, you divide one into the other and you get the number of years.
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah.
So that will go in on by this Friday, and that's something that Judy and I have been working on.
Okay, good.
So Judy's been doing a lot of the heavy lifting, so thanks to her.
Fred had emailed.
I'm not surprised. Okay.
So that will go through.
I guess we have this. Why don't we go to Blue School Future?
So you got mass preservation.
Well, can we do it in 3 minutes or?
No.
Because Eversource is at 6:15. I'm just trying to be
efficient. Well, are you done with it?
We're done with green communities.
Done with green communities, yeah.
Are you going to do the preservation one too?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, you might want to stack. If you can.
Okay.
Well, I don't think the poll hearing is going to take a long time.
Okay,
I don't know, though. You're going to take a long time or you're going to be quick? Well, the Blue School won't take long either, right? Let's talk about that for 2 minutes and then.
So quickly, I have heard that I'm meeting with the superintendent, the town administrators, and the business manager, and they are reactivating the committee who selected the central office relocation.
Those people to
eventually dispose of the Blue School.
They want to pay us to take it back or what?
pay us our dollar back.
Yeah. I don't think we want to do it.
I don't know. It depends. Depends on a couple things.
We could put storage in the, you know.
I mean, we need to look at specific certain costs of things. And
yes.
I mean, does it make sense if we could take it back and demolish it for a reasonable price and then have a 2-acre lot to do something with, housing or?
Yeah, maybe.
I guess, I like to see their report that consultant did on the environmental conditions at a school and why they decided to leave. That was a major factor. I guess I like to see that report to see if we, because we're going to need to know some of that if we decide to sell it or remodel it or whatever. People are going to want to know that.
Yeah.
I guess to know what we're accepting. And the other thing, thinking ahead, is we're going to have another property come vacant soon. Well, within a year or so. Plus, we got a parcel of land that's vacant, been vacant for a while, that maybe we ought to take a look at these three parcels and decide what's the best option to go as to whether advertise as is or to do some demolishing and cleaning up of the parcels to get a better price.
Yeah.
Well, perhaps we ought to, going back to the commercial real estate idea, we got three properties. We have the space in here, and we have the center school, and we have the blue building.
We don't have the blue building.
Not yet.
No.
Yeah.
But we could get it, I'm sure.
We have a right of first refusal.
We do.
Yeah. We could
bid a little less than a dollar because of inflation. And, but at any rate, those are three properties. That we should, well, I agree with Fred, we should figure out what we're going to do with them and maybe get some, professional opinion on what makes the most sense, what our options are. I don't want to necessarily get the blue building back if it's a liability in terms of asbestos or whatever, a brownfield or a septic system that doesn't work or HVAC system that needs replacement and on and on and on, and the same with the center school.
there's a lot of detail on the blue school. They have an easement on town property for the septic. It's very convoluted, so there'd be a lot of in-depth on that.
Right, and I just don't want to acquire a liability.
Well, you mentioned three. That wasn't the three I had.
Oh.
Then we're going to do a fourth one. Is a DeMile property that's been sitting vacant for a while. What's the best way to market that? Do we hire somebody to clean it up and advertise commercial, or do we go, a housing committee is still looking at that as a possible option for future housing.
When you say clean up, you mean environmental clean up?
Clean up, yes, because we've been told that the existing septic is within the limits of the wetlands and cannot be used.
Really?
So, yes.
Yeah, what about other underground tanks?
We don't know.
How did DeMayo get away with that?
Well, whenever it was put in, I guess it was.
It was an existing building.
Yeah.
It was acceptable design.
It's a septic system.
It was just no more building.
Well,
I think it goes, it's like your house. Your system fails, you can put a septic anywhere.
Right.
If the house wasn't there, you couldn't
do that. Okay, well, anyway, these are questions.
We got three or four properties.
These are questions we need to resolve. And I would say, I don't know what the priority, I think the priority should be this space over here and then deal with these other spaces.
Because at some point, I think we'll get a, at some point, it's going to come formally before you about the book school.
That's fine.
But I would still ask them for that report. Whether we, regardless of what way we decide in the blue school, I guess to know what's there.
And I want enough time before we're formally asked to do something and exercise our first right of refusal or not to be able to scope it out so we don't inherit a blue elephant, as it were. So, anyway, okay, so it's Eversource time, I guess. you want to come forward and...
Sure. Do you want to sit right here?
Sure.
All right. So on River Road...
You are?
I'm sorry, Nick with Eversource.
Nick with Eversource.
Nick Trigo with Eversource.
And I'm sorry, your last name?
C-R.
C-R?
E-I. G-L-E.
Okay, thank you.
I got it.
64 River Road, they have a direct buried service that comes across the road that's faulted, so it's temped, fixed right now, overhead, but we're getting around to fixing it. Met with the homeowner a few times on site, and she didn't want the pole on the right side of her property, so we put it where she requested. There is a like temp driveway on that side. She wanted it as close to the driveway as she could, as it could be for her to maintain that area. It's one pole with the guy. It's pretty straightforward.
Well,
I did ask Keith to take a look at it.
Good.
And he took a look at it, and I guess he had some discussions with Eversource.
Yep, he called me this morning.
Who it was, and he seems to be okay with it in terms of the public safety aspect.
Well, I have some serious misgivings, but I'm going to ignore him for now. So, no, I'm kidding. I don't. Yeah, I don't care.
Where is the associated guy crossover pole? Is that on the same side as the new pole or across the street?
So the blue poles are the existing.
Blue pole?
Oh, we all get black.
Oh, you guys got black and white. So
here's blue.
Oh, you got a color copy.
Well, they have the circle with the X in it.
Yep, yeah. So the circle with the X, those are the existing. It's a crossover pole, so she can go underground with her service again, rather than having to dig across the road.
I like that. Underground service.
Yep.
That's fine. Okay. Anything else?
Okay.
Well, thank you. Oh, we have to sign.
Sign those, please. We'll mail that back to you, right?
Yep.
Or to Nicole?
Yeah, to Nicole, if you could.
Say hi to Linda Julio. You know her?
Don't know her.
She works in Hadley.
Which department?
Eversource. Conservation.
Conservation, okay.
All right. Well, thanks so much.
Rick, thank you, guys.
A good presentation, by the way.
Have a good one.
All right, Nick, with Eversource.
Got it.
Greatly.
Is that like Jake from State Farm?
Yeah. All right. I think it's Judy's turn. Oh, well, we're talking about mass preservation project.
I have moral support.
And answer the hard questions.
Okay.
One of the things that, so for the town hall funding, there are three grants we were thinking about applying for.
Yes.
The third one is the mass preservation project fund.
And the other one was the green communities.
Green communities and the cultural fund.
Yeah.
And you have in your packet here a handout that talks about the Mass Preservation Project Fund Grant Preservation Restriction Overview. So one of the requirements, if the grant were to be awarded to us, is that the town would need to grant preservation restriction,
right,
on the building.
Certain historical aspects.
Right,
got it.
Yep, and it could be interior or exterior.
Read it.
So, it's just a consideration that we want to consider in terms of applying for this grant.
Well, I assume Jones Witsit are well aware of all this. Okay.
I mean, the question is, it's going to, I believe that the town, we would need to get a vote of town meeting to grant the restriction.
Okay.
So.
But then it wouldn't be final until we get the grant?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right?
So what this kind of says, so.
We would need to authorize.
You would need to say in advance
that we're
that you're willing to do it.
Yeah.
To be eligible for the grant. Right. But if you don't, if we don't get the grant, it's a moot point.
Or if we don't get the restriction, we don't get the money.
We would get to custom tailor it to the building, and we have talked to people from another town that actually got three of these preservation grants. They've had one on their town hall for since 1999 and had no problems with Mass Historical at all with it.
I would think they would love to have our building.
So this is an upfront grant, or is it reimbursable?
Reimbursable.
It's reimbursable, so we have to come up with a short-term borrowing or whatever.
The cash money from the CPA will cover the reimbursement portion, as well as the match.
We have to sign something, or?
Oh, I just wanted to let you know that if we want to move forward with this, we need to put the, this is going to be an article on the annual town meeting warrant.
Well, I'm all for it. Right?
Okay, yes.
I think there has to be a document in the application side that says we would do it.
Yep.
Along with the warrant vote.
Okay. So if it passes the warrant vote, then we sign this thing and we send it off.
Well, the deadline.
No, I mean before.
Before.
Unfortunately, the deadline for all of these is before town meeting, but they will.
So we can pitch on it at town meeting.
Yeah.
All right, Fred, you got to talk this up in your information session.
Yes. Okay.
All right, we're good. Thank you, Judy.
Yeah. Are you on the Historical Commission? This is, tell me if this is right or wrong. Let's say we decide to tear down the center school, just for sake of discussion. Does the Historical Commission have the right to put a one-year moratorium? It does not.
Not waiting.
I thought I'd read that in some towns, but apparently not.
Towns that have what they call a demolition delay bylaw.
Okay, so we can just do it.
No. It's not on the historic register.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not on the historic register. Where is it?
I thought it was 100-year or older was what the town.
Well, there were several countries. It's not in a national register district the way the center school is.
The center school is a national registered district. Okay. That's the
school. But
that doesn't provide any restrictions on certain. I'm not saying, I was
just curious. Right. On the use of it, if it goes private use or doesn't matter. Okay.
Okay. Well, thank you, Judy.
Yes, thank you.
Wish us luck.
I wish us luck. We're all in it together.
Could we go back to the blue school just for a minute?
No.
Okay, 30 seconds.
Yeah, okay.
Fred has a connection on the housing committee, and I don't know the young woman's name, who's very involved in housing.
Right.
The last discussion I had with her, she was having lunch with the developer of the Sunderland project for income eligible seniors. So my only thought being, if she could talk to him and just look at the blue school, to just say, you guys are out of your mind, tear it down, or I could get you, because you know that's a big field. You could put 10 little condos in there, and maybe with the building.
More solar collectors.
Solar.
Yeah,
the building itself might be suitable for affordable housing. I don't think the center school is, but
talk about the blue school.
Yeah, the blue school might well be.
But yeah, we just have this particular connection. I don't know if you were in the meeting, but she said she was having lunch with the Sunderland developer.
I think we ought to pursue whatever avenues we got, because we want to do something with this property.
Yeah, just to have some input.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't look seriously at that, but we didn't know it was going to be turned back to the town. There's a possibility of it, but locations we've been looking at so far are on a bus route. Because so many low-income people or seniors don't have transportation.
Right.
Buses go by every day on state roads.
If we had 10 or 12 units there, the bus might.
Well, might, yeah. Right.
But if you wouldn't mind asking for that.
Yeah, I'll put that on our next agenda here.
Great. Okay, so are we at solar projects now?
Yep.
Okay.
So I had a meeting with folks from NextAmp last week, and they have two solar projects in the works.
Two in Whately?
Two in Whately.
Wow. Both on Christian Lane?
Do they already own projects in Whately?
They have one, Fairview Farms.
Fairview Farms.
Oh, that's nice, yeah.
Okay.
And you see, one is 211 Christian Lane, the other one's 134 Christian Lane. I've actually asked that they come to our next meeting.
Okay, that'd be good.
The next regular select board meeting, because we need to talk about pilot agreements for these two projects. They like to have a certainty in the pilot when they try to figure out their final financing for the projects.
Interesting layout. It's near, what is that?
This is by the school. That's by the school, yeah. The school is right in there. The school is right there.
Is that the school?
Yeah, that's the blue school.
Speaking of the blue school.
Oh, that's the blue school. Right, that's what I'm saying.
The house there is Gripko's.
Gripko's house, that's what I meant. And it's right, so that's right along, that's almost in Wetlands, isn't it? Wetlands offset. Oh, I see. Okay. And whose property is it on?
It's Hutkowski.
That's Hutkowski.
And these are both 400 feet back from the road, because that's the other requirement.
Looks like it. Says.
You could scale it off, but okay.
Yep. And these still need to go for permitting with the town.
This is a large array.
Yep.
We got 350 or one-third of a megawatt times one-third of a kilowatt.
Yep. So I think they said 1.3 megawatts and
1.3 and 2.6.
I think.
Is that what it says somewhere?
Yeah, total array size.
What's the line? Is that?
KWDC.
Oh, right, 2.6. Wow, we got a lot of solar lately.
Yep.
If you add it all up. What's Alan got there, Sanderson's? Do you know? That's at least two, I would say.
I think it's over two, but I don't recall exactly what it is.
Okay.
So they'll come in, they want to talk about the pilot agreement. They wanted to basically have it be the same as the one that they have with the town for Fairview Farms with two changes. One, the one for Fairview Farms is a 25-year pilot agreement. They want to go down to 20. And then the current one for Fairview Farms has a 2.5% escalator. They were hoping the town would agree to a 2% escalator. So those are things that
we'll
want to discuss with them.
Yeah, we got to discuss this. I want to know what the effect is. As it is right now, are these lands, this is farmland?
Yep.
Yes.
I believe they said both of these are chapter lands.
Oh, they are?
And they would need to take them out.
Oh, so the town would actually get more revenue for
the
this
town
land?
Yes, pilot agreement. The pilot agreement.
It
was around.
It's a deduct if they're in chapter. So if we take them out of chapter.
I'm not sure the smaller one is in chapter land, though.
I mean, it's also that the smaller one's very wet. Not wetlands wet, but not very good.
They said they fought both of them more. Maybe they're wrong. I'm not sure, but it would be the price in the current pilot, the Fairview Farms between NextAmp and the town is $6,150 per megawatt. So
per year.
Yep, per year. With a 2.5% escalator each year. So the 2.6, that's around 2.5 times that. And then the 1.3 would be.
But we're using the same price as I don't know if you said, and hear everything you said, maybe. The one behind the town garage, it's the same price for that, right?
Is that Fairview?
No, their own, but I think we had the same price per kilowatt.
I haven't seen that pilot.
I think so.
I wanted to keep both the same.
When we discuss this with NextAmp, could you work up a revenue stream for the town with and without the solar? I want to compare and also include the Sanderson insulation and the one behind the transfer station.
Right.
It seems like a win-win, except for the fact you're taking land out of agriculture, but...
The only one that...
The wetland one probably doesn't have much, as Dan says. That's right next to a creek, and it's wet there, so maybe there's a really good use for it.
And the other thing was the town getting electricity off of this?
No. And that's the other question that I spoke with them briefly about who their off-takers were.
Yeah.
And they said they don't know exactly. And
they have to have a certain percentage of off-takers, right?
Right. They said that if the town was interested, it was a conversation we could have with them.
Well, let's see about that.
Yeah, I think
it may need to be different from the permitting people, but if we want to pursue that.
Well, we could cut our electricity bill by a lot. But, of course, then that might affect the pilot agreement, too. I don't know.
It could.
All right, well, to be continued then.
Yeah, so they're going to come. And the other catch is, speaking of town meeting, requires town meeting vote.
Okay.
The Board of Select, so we'll have two articles, if we agree to move forward with this on the Eno town meeting, where we'd ask the residents to authorize the Select Board to enter into a pilot agreement with Nexamp for these two projects.
Good.
So we wouldn't finalize it until after
the Eno town meeting. That's good. And by then, we'll have a lot of more information. Okay, personnel committee recommendations, updated sick leave policy. Sounds good to me. Of course, I was on this committee.
Right. You want me to run through it?
Well, you might as well, for the sake of the TV audience.
Yeah. We'll do the Cliff Notes version. So right now...
Do people still use Cliff Notes?
I think so. They're online now. Electronic.
Online.
You should check your students. They might be
using it. Yeah, right. They just... Never mind. Sorry. Go ahead.
Well, one of the issues with the current sick leave policy is that when a new employee starts, they would not accrue sick time or be allowed, they would not earn sick time until the next July 1st.
Beginning of the fiscal year.
Right, the beginning of the next fiscal year. So there could be a situation where somebody is hired in June and they don't have sick time for the next 11 months. So the personnel committee wanted to look at that and see if there's a way where, and there is a way, and that's what's proposed here, is where sick time could accrue each pay period.
Each bi-weekly pay period.
Right.
Yeah.
Each bi-weekly pay period. So that right now it's you earn it, then you get it. You earn it and you get it in one lump sum on July 1st of the next fiscal year. And the proposal from the personnel committee is that it would accrue each pay period. So full-time employees would get three, whatever it is there, 3.077 hours per pay period for a total of 80 hours.
Per year.
Full-time, part-time employees will be prorated, and then there's maximums. There's maximums now. We're not changing the maximums. It's 720 hours of sick time that an employee can accrue. A full-time employee can accrue. Yet part-time employees are prorated. Once you reach that max, you can't keep accruing above that.
For sick leave, either, you see?
That's just for sick leave. Yeah, this is just sick leave right now.
What's the max, 120?
The 720 is the max current.
720.
Yep.
Okay. Would it be any easier accounting purposes if you made these whole hours and then at the end of the year added the extra one in to make up?
Does it matter? The computer is going to take it out so many spaces.
So it doesn't matter. Okay.
It doesn't matter what you do. The computer's automatically going to do. Harper's will have it set up to carry out, I believe, three.
Yeah. My prior appointment was full hours, and at the last one, they gave you two extra to make up for the decimal difference, or three extra on the last one of the year. But okay, as long as they can handle it, fine.
Right. So that's sick leave. That's right. Section C here, and D is vacation. again, it's looking, it's forward-looking. Right now, in terms of vacation, if a new employee would come in, and they wouldn't earn anything, but they wouldn't earn anything, or they couldn't use anything until July 1st of the next fiscal year. The idea is sick leave would accrue by pay period, and vacation leave would accrue by pay period. And that seems to be the way that it's, that it is in the private sector.
I'm okay with that.
The one bigger change is that now employees can't carry over any vacation time. This would allow carryover equal to the amount that they could earn in the previous fiscal year, because we need to adjust from everybody accruing July 1st and moving forward. So that was necessary to catch people up.
We should slow down so John gets to have some meeting time.
Sure. Is there a limit of the? I know you carry over, you can do next year, but for the second year, if they didn't use it all, if they still have off, can they still carry over?
No.
It's in your package.
It goes back to.
Yep.
So how much they have accrued that year.
So if someone has 2 weeks at the end of this year, they can carry over 2 weeks and then start accruing.
Right, but at the end of that second year, if they haven't used the 2 weeks.
If they have anything more than two, we can't carry it over.
Oh, okay. Okey-dokey.
Wait, so is this the recommendation of the personnel committee?
Yes.
And so it's a perpetual 2 week carryover.
It's a carryover equal to whatever the person,
whatever they have remaining,
whatever they are in that previous.
Right, but it can't be beyond 2 weeks. You can't carry over 3 weeks.
It depends on what somebody's earned.
Depends on your.
So I get that, long you've been there.
There are a lot of places that don't allow you to carry over more than under the concept of it's a good idea to take vacation.
Yeah.
And if somebody's just banking it, because the challenge with this also is if people continue to bank vacation and it accumulates to 5-6 weeks,
right.
Usually those policies have with it a payout if the person leaves, and that can be a budget buster. And I really don't think that we should be in the business of allowing people to carry over, because
they only carry 1 year.
But if you don't take vacation for, as I understand it, if you don't take a vacation for 3 years, you can carry over that entire
3 years.
No. Whatever you could earn that previous fiscal year.
Whatever in year one, what you.
So you can't just never take a vacation
right.
And have it all carry over.
Right.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Well, I was talking before. The way it is now is, you get if you're hired. Say you're hired at the end of June. I'm sorry, that's not a good example. You're hired at the end of August. You have to wait until July 1st until you're able to take your vacation time.
Which I think is ridiculous.
And that's the same with sick leave, so you have people who may get sick and then they're scrambling to take time off or work up extra hours or something or have unpaid time because they're sick and they can't take sick leave.
So that was changed.
That was the genesis behind it, changing for the sick leave.
I'll read it, but I struggle with just the accumulation concept in general. If you start on August 1st, then it's prorated to 9.5 days of vacation, whatever the vacation policy is.
Yep.
2 weeks is silly too, but that's another issue. It should be 3 weeks. But if you, let's say you have 9.5 days coming to you. You should be able to take 9.5 days whenever you decide to take it. You shouldn't have to wait. Because someone who starts on August 1st, if they haven't had a vacation by June 30th, they're not as good an employee on June 30th as they were on August 1st. They're just not. So I would request that the personnel committee consider doing away with accumulation, and that's what you get. And unless people take advantage of the situation, then that would be the policy that you take it whenever you take it.
You're saying that you use it the year it's earned or you lose it?
I'm saying, and then with that goes that you don't have to wait for you to accumulate that time in a given year. You just let's say July 1st hits, and you're going to take get 2 weeks vacation that year. And just, you know what, if you want to go on vacation the week of July 13th, you should be able to go on vacation.
Well, we talked about that, didn't we? You can take an advance.
But you're accruing each pay period, so it's not like.
I don't think we've agreed on anything.
Yeah, I'm saying get rid of the accrual.
Just give them the full amount at the beginning of the year.
You're
two
saying
weeks,
forward-looking.
Forward-looking, whatever you have in that two-week period of time.
Lump sum forward-looking, because right now it's you accumulate it from the prior year.
And you're going backwards, right?
What you're saying is, why not do a lump sum at the beginning of the fiscal year? What that would mean is employees. Or about to catch people up.
How would you handle new hires then? They would get that full amount?
You might have to wait.
If they're not in the fiscal year.
You might have to wait 6 months.
Or make for new hires.
But then, do away with this accumulation thing. It's like 1950s management style. Wow. And we're in the 21st century. And yes, new hire 6 months, whatever that comfort level is, so that we don't have people starting their job, taking a vacation, and saying, you know, it turns out this job's not for me.
Right, that's something I want to protect against.
Well, I was used to that working for the government. That I don't remember how you first started, whether your first year you got anything, but it was every payday you got leave accrued, and you could carry that amount over for 1 year, right, the full amount. So after the first year, or at the beginning of the second year, you got the full amount on July 1 or January 1 that you could take. But you had to wait that year or something to get that.
And my point is, why wait?
Well, the why wait, but you can't have a 6 month from the hire. They got to start. When they hire, then they get it.
Okay, well, whatever. I'd rather do that than because, again, let's treat our employees like the professionals that they are.
Okay, but if you give them that when you first hire it, and after a month or two, they quit.
Well, they could sign something saying, I have to pay back the money if, I mean, that's just contractual. And we're not an organized shop, so it's not like we get into Dutch with collective bargaining.
Right, no, we don't do that much hiring.
Right. But let's treat people. We respect them. We value them. We appreciate what they're going to give to the community if they're new hires. We're not going to hire someone who thinks they're going to take advantage of a situation, because anyone who we think is going to take advantage of a situation, we don't probably aren't going to hire them. I've never understood it. And if someone can explain it to me, great. But I've never understood the accrual process. Why we do it? You don't have a vacation for an entire year.
So that would apply to Brian. He doesn't get anything.
Of course it would.
Well, then what he's getting every pay.
I don't understand.
Brian has an employment agreement.
Yeah, if we have these accrual limits here. So if you've worked 5 years but less than 10, you get 120 vacation hours, yeah, right? So each pay period, you're granted 4.6 hours. Right. And once you start employment, you should start accruing vacation leave at that rate, it would seem to me.
Right.
Okay, and then, you know, if you start in December, whatever, you start accruing at that rate for each pay period, correct?
Yeah.
And then, I'm not sure what the, at the end of each fiscal year, employees shall be allowed to carry over to the next fiscal year a maximum amount of accrued vacation equal to the which they earned the previous year. I mean, that sounds reasonable to me. John, I don't know what the problem with that is.
I don't mind the carryover. What I'm saying is, why not just give the person the ability to take a vacation within that first year?
I don't think we're denying that.
No, they haven't accrued. I mean, why not give the person the opportunity to not have to wait for accrual?
Well, if somebody hires in December, say, fiscal year starts in July 1st, and they accrue whatever the rate is, they accrue 30 hours of vacation pay.
Let's call it a week.
A week of vacation?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Then they should be able to take a week's vacation.
Right, in that first 6 months.
Well, we did have a probation period of some number of days, right, for new hires, like 90 days.
But the way this reads, you have to accrue. You would not be able to take your kids to Disneyland.
I don't get that out of this, frankly. I don't see that that's what this is saying. It seems to me you're accruing a certain rate not to exceed a certain total in any given fiscal year.
But if you haven't accrued it, you haven't accrued it.
Well, you have to work to accrue. So
right, that's my point.
Every pay period, you accrue right. more time. And you would like them to be able to take an advance. If they work in December and they want to take a week off, they would have to wait. They would have to wait to accrue 40 hours of vacation leave right. at a rate of, let's say, 3 hours per pay period. So they couldn't.
No, they couldn't. That's my point.
They couldn't. Okay, so what you're suggesting, it seems to me, is to allow them to take an advance. So then that gets deducted from future accruals.
Yeah. I mean, call it an advance. I just call it, if you know you're going to have 2 weeks of vacation in a given fiscal year, you can take that 2 weeks whenever the need arises.
Well, I think it's more straightforward maybe to say, okay, so you get 120 hours or whatever, 2 weeks or 3 weeks. You can take that during the fiscal year. That's your discretion. But if somebody is hired, like in April or May, more month in the fiscal year, they can't take a week off.
No, they can take a day off because that's what they were going to be. That's what they would
have accrued
by the end of June.
Well, it seems to me this isn't that far off from what you're suggesting.
It's just that first year you're really restricted. The first year you're restricted. You can't take your kid.
Okay, so if you start July 1st, it's going to take you a few months to get 2 weeks accrual. So you can't take your vacation until...
Right, and you know, and we want to be hiring people with children in school, and that means that February vacation, April vacation, Christmas vacation, you know, the Christmas vacation, what do you do with your children?
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. I'm sure we talked about that.
I'm sure we did at one point. I don't think it went anywhere, but... I mean, as you know, we've all been parents, and we've all scratched our heads saying, what do we do with our kids on February vacation?
I think the concern might have been on the part of some members is that people might take advantage of that. Cash out, take their vacation, then quit.
Right, and then
that seems a little drastic.
Have them sign something saying, and if you do this, you will have to owe the town back wages, or whatever, however it's worded. And I don't know whether that would pass legal muster, but there are ways to figure out how to do this and still protect the town from that.
I'm okay with that.
And I don't know how to protect the town from the scenario that we've pointed out, but that's the only downside.
You want to check into that, Brian?
Yeah.
Fred, are you okay with this, where we're going?
Yeah.
Then we should probably bring it back.
Yeah, I think
so. We're having a personnel committee meeting on Wednesday.
Yeah.
Okay, good point.
The other thing, reading this about carryover, it says, okay, if you look at the middle paragraph, I mean, page, using the 80 hours, somebody gets 80 hours and don't use it at the end of the year.
Yep.
They can carry over that 80 hours at the end of that second year. Well, no, it says end of the second year, they can carry over 80 hours equal to the amount they got the first year. They don't use any. So end of year two, they could get 160 hours.
No, that's not the intent.
Let me finish where I was going, and you tell me if I'm reading it incorrectly. Then in year three, it says they can still be accruing vacation time on top of what's carried over. So at the end of year three, they'd have 3 years of vacation time they could use. They'd have to use or lose the 2 years.
No. That wasn't the intent here is Employees should be allowed to carry over to the next fiscal year a maximum amount of accrued vacation leave equal to the total amount of vacation leave which they earned during the previous fiscal year.
Right.
Okay, so they carry over 80 hours. They didn't use any.
Yeah.
Okay. They still accrue vacation during the upcoming fiscal year. Okay, so they could accrue another 80 hours during the year.
Yep. And if they didn't use that, they would lose it.
They could only take over another 80.
Well, they would go back to 80 then after year two if they didn't use anything.
It wouldn't be 160.
Right. It's not cumulative. The other... Someone who's been here, and I'm going to use the extreme, someone who's it's been wonderful, they've been here for 20 years. 200 hours is
5 weeks.
5 weeks, dang. If I'm looking to retire, and I know I'm going to retire, my dirty little secret, I'm going to retire. I really do struggle with someone just saying, geez, I'm going to be on vacation the rest of my life. I'm going to bank this 5 weeks, and they're going to have to pay out 5 weeks' salary, which...
10 weeks.
10 weeks, because you can carry five.
Carry five over, so if you don't use it...
You're not going to get it. Let's say you retire in... Well, yes, you could wait until the end of the fiscal year, so it could be 10 weeks, or you could retire the day after the fiscal year, so it would be five.
Right.
So 10 weeks... That's a good chunk of change, and that is a budget buster for a small town like Whately.
Yeah.
I struggle with that. Now, yeah, it's wonderful that they spent 20 years with the town. I'm sure we benefited from it, but that's a lot of money to all of a sudden say, oh, what do we do?
Well, they're not going to be happy with me, but you can also bank, 126 days.
I know.
That's paid out differently, though.
Yeah.
That's what?
The sick leave is paid out differently.
Okay.
Well, what's the average pay?
But your concern is about...
If it's $25 an hour and you're talking 400 hours, so that's what,
$10,000?
$25 an hour? Yeah, I don't know what's the average pay for everybody. Is it higher than that?
$30? Lower.
Yeah. Well, not if it's a 5 week person.
And nobody's making $25 an hour.
Well, so 23.
Well, what's like with the police chief?
Jimmy Keith.
That's your high end, but your average worker is not.
Right, the high end. The high end could be tough, but the average worker is going to be making $15 an hour, whatever, 16, 17, 18 bucks an hour, whatever it is. But still, it's a number that you didn't all of a sudden plan on, and it puts the town in an awkward budget position potentially. So I'm just wondering, do we cap? Well, is it legal to cap the pay? I don't know how you do that without. Well, the other side of that coin is then all of a sudden someone says, I'm retiring on June 30th, 2019. And then they stop working on April 15th, 2019, whatever I said, because they've got in vacation. They're just getting paid for. Starting their retirement.
That's how most places do it. You just get out early.
Right, and...
I'm right or wrong, that's just how most places do it.
Right. And then someone like... And let's say it's a policeman. Or, you know, in Whately, it's limited in terms of the number of positions that would be policeman or road crew. You have to find replacement parts for those 10 weeks. What do you do?
Which you'd have to find it anyway if they're leaving.
You have to fund the person's salary and you have to fund the replacement part.
Right. But you'd still be hiring somebody anyway, eventually.
Not if they take it a week at a time. I get that, but you're adding an expense that wasn't anticipated.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's, how do you think we should control this?
I don't know. I'm just bringing up the issue.
Yeah.
It's just something we need to think, and we're not going to decide here.
No.
But it's an issue that we really should think about.
So you want to kick it back to the personnel committee to consider caps on carryover? I mean, is that what you're...
Well, what we want to avoid is, I think what John's saying is somebody could accrue 10 weeks.
10 weeks. And retire.
10 weeks and retire. You know, of course, you want to provide incentive by giving vacation.
Or they could do, if they're at the 3-week level, they could do 6 weeks. I mean, they could double their...
Right. So you're incentivizing people to not use their vacation leave in any given fiscal year and to use double that in a succeeding fiscal year. And if it happens that they've been 20 years or over, that amounts to 10 weeks they can use their last year and leave 10 weeks early.
Right.
Now, is that a... And you're saying that's a budget buster.
Well, because you have to replace that person.
Well, yeah, you have to replace the person. You have to pay them for 10 weeks. But you would have had to, I mean...
Might be cheaper than a gold watch.
I don't know if there's an easy way.
I think...
Well, the fair thing is they get 200 hours. They get 5 weeks if they've worked 20 years and over. So, their last year, they should get 5 weeks. Why should they get 10?
Because they roll over.
I know, but
right.
is that fair?
Yeah, maybe the rollover is capped at a certain number of weeks. Maybe it's capped at 2 weeks. So if you don't take, if you're a 5-week employee, or whatever you are, you can only roll over 2 of those weeks.
The underlying issue here is how do we catch people up? So there's some employees who we are going to owe, let's say, 5 weeks vacation time come July 1 for the work they're doing this fiscal year.
Because they haven't taken any vacation.
Right. Let's say they haven't taken it. No. Because
that's what they earn this fiscal year.
Then they get to use it the next fiscal year.
Okay.
So it's earned this fiscal year, but they can't touch it.
Well, they could touch it. They could touch it incrementally.
No, we can't.
Not right now.
Until July 1st.
No, right.
Oh, you can't do any incremental use right now.
No.
Oh, that's interesting.
July 1st, we get awarded vacation earned this current fiscal year.
So there's a couple people who have banked who on July 1st are gonna have banked 5 weeks of vacation time that the town, in all respects, owes them. So how do we go from accruing from the from the past to
full booking. You do away with the accrual process. Like I was suggesting before, your first year, you start from the first year, you don't accrue. You are given this amount of time and you're allowed to roll over a certain percentage of that time. So if you start, I'm gonna just make the math easy. You start on July 1st. You're gonna have 2 weeks, right? In the first year, is that our vacation policy?
Well,
it depends on.
For a new employee, so you're saying going forward,
you just take that 2 weeks and that, so the only rollover is any time that you didn't use in that first year and in subsequent years. But the accrual is the reason we're behind the eight ball from the get-go because of the first year policy.
Well, that's not the accrual. I mean, per pay period, I mean, we're behind because we've been looking behind instead of looking forward.
Right. Well, let's look forward. But that is accrual. That looking behind is basically accrual.
It seems to me once we got the person in the system over after the first fiscal year or whatever part of that they worked, and they get to accrue whatever fraction of their first year of employment is, they get to pull that into the second year of employment and add it to whatever they accrue that year. Then we could stop accrual after that.
You could cap it at a certain.
Or we could just,
yeah.
You know, I mean, if they don't, if in the second year they,
why have the each pay period amount? Okay, what you're saying, Jonathan, given the 80 hours on July 1 of every year. That employee.
Assuming they're a full-time employee.
Full-time employee. Every July 1, they get 80 hours. And that's it, whether they work 6 months of that year or 12 months, they get is the 80 hours.
That's what they get. And then obviously their third year, whenever they go up to the third, to the 3 weeks vacation,
yeah,
or the 120 hours, whatever it is.
But so that's forward looking. So right, we still have employees who we would owe 80 hours. Yes. So how do we?
We got to catch.
How do we transition?
Two types of employee we're talking about.
Yeah, right.
Kick them back to the person.
Some employees. I mean, that's, I guess that's probably the resolution we'll have tonight is.
Yeah. With this thought process under their belt. But there's got to be a way to catch them up. But and maybe the way to do it is, let's use the easy one, the someone who's on July 1st starting their second year of employment. Mm-hmm. And by the current system they're under, they go into July 1st with 2 weeks vacation to take.
Based on the fact that they,
right,
from the past fiscal year.
Right. So then they suddenly have 4 weeks. And you can say, you know what, this year we're going to let you take 3 weeks because it's going to be your previous two. And then we're going to move you towards the looking forward. So you can look forward for a week. And then in the next year, you'll catch up for that second week. And then you're looking forward the whole time. Then you've caught up. So you catch up over a 2 year period of time.
Then they're getting two full years of time after that second year.
No, they're getting the 2 weeks for their first year of service and 2 weeks for their second year of service. Or they're getting, what they're getting is after the second year of service, they will have taken 3 of their 4 weeks. And after the third year of service, they will have taken 6 of their 6 weeks.
Okay. So all you're saving is in the first year or two.
Yeah, that's all, because you're catching up.
Yeah.
And you could treat it the same way, whether they're in the 5th year or 6th year, 7th year of their, I mean, how long have you been here?
7 years.
And so whatever, you know, then Mary Ellen over the next 2 years, and I'm just using you as the example because you're sitting here, over the next 2 years, again, starting July 1st, you start to catch up over a 2 year period of time. So you're probably a 3 weeks vacation or 120 hour equivalent.
Right.
You start to catch that up in fiscal 18, and then you finish catching up in fiscal 19, and then in fiscal 20, she's just looking forward. And maybe there are nuances that I'm missing, but.
I think, I mean, the pushback that you might hear is, as of now, we would owe those employees their weeks on July 1st.
Going backwards.
Yeah. And you're saying to stretch that out over a
2 year period of time.
2 year period of time.
Because they're automatically getting the going forward.
Right.
So on July 1st, they get the 2 weeks going forward, and they're going to catch up one of the weeks going backwards. And then in the next fiscal year, they'll get their next 2 weeks still, and then they'll catch up that final week going forward. And then they're caught up, and then it's just going forward. It's just an idea.
Well, we'll look at it.
Are you going to talk about the COLA?
Yep. Just to go back for 1 second. Are we thinking the same in terms of the sick leave or not?
Well, that's a 90-day cap anyway.
90-day cap?
Yeah, it's a carryover until you reach 90 days of sick time. And it's capped automatically at 90 days. And there's no budget issues with that because...
Right, so the question is, the way the policy's written right now is it's accrued for pay period. Are we also talking about doing a lump sum at the beginning of the fiscal year or no?
Again, I'll bring in the private sector into this. When I hire somebody, I actually, a lot of places are going towards, they don't have sick days. You don't get them. If you're sick, you're sick. You don't accrue them, you don't use them up, you're sick. I mean, that's how I am treated.
Well, if you're sick, you're sick. What do you mean? You're on a salary, so... Or you don't get paid for those things.
No, you get paid. You're on salary. You get your hourly.
That's good if you're on a salary.
But if you're on hourly, you can still do that. I was sick today. I was supposed to, I had an 8-hour shift. I'm going to get paid for that 8-hour shift. If I do that for more than 3 days in a row, I better have a doctor's note saying why I'm sick. I'm not saying it can work in the public sector. I'm just saying that's the...
But that gives them, what, roughly 18 days you have to take?
Well, they're getting 10 hours a year, 10 days a year, like 80 hours.
Yeah, that's the existing policy right now.
80 hours, okay. So that's 10 days, okay. You accumulate to maximum of 720 hours, so that's... which is like 18 weeks, so yeah.
And what can you get paid out? All of it?
You don't get paid out unless you've been here, I think it's 20 years. There's a buyback that you get a day per year that you've worked. But I can leave tomorrow and I won't get paid any sick time.
Okay.
So there's no budget implications.
Right. Okay.
If you retire, you get a day of sick leave for every year of service.
Assuming you haven't used it.
Which is...
Or you have them in the bank.
Which is insignificant.
Right.
Which isn't missing that much. Okay. So we'll kick both these back to the personnel committee to talk about.
What was the payout for those? Did you retire?
For sick leave? One day of sick leave for each full year of service to the town.
So it's not a lot.
No, it doesn't sound like it. I thought there was if you had 720, you retired, you got a percentage of that.
No, it's one day per year.
I must have misunderstood.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on to COLA and salary adjustments.
Yep, there's a memorandum here that summarizes what the personnel committee talked about. The recommended COLA the personnel committee voted on was 3% based on the CPIU for the Boston, Brockton, Nashua area. So that would go to the finance committee for their consideration and for your consideration. There'll be a discussion at
Wednesday.
We can talk about it Wednesday.
Why are they using that area?
That's the area for our region.
The most relevant
region.
Area to us.
Wait, that's
more in that region rather than the Springfield?
They don't separate it out.
Springfield's in that region.
No.
Well, according to whoever came up with this, where did the CPI come from?
It comes from the...
I know it comes from the government, but
right.
Your labor standards.
I don't have a sheet with me.
It's the Department of Labor website. It's the ones that produce it.
And it must be all Massachusetts. It's on the same one.
Mm-hmm. And they're saying that the CPI went up 3% last year?
Yeah.
I find that hard to believe. Social Security went up, was it 0.3 or 0.03%?
Yeah, it's something different. Well, I mean, I'll bring the printout to the meeting. That's what it was.
I know, but
we can set it as something 12, different. But that's
a 12-month
that's
average.
What they set it at,
right?
Yeah,
the last 12 months.
It seems high. I mean, energy prices haven't gone up 3%.
I think that was the biggest factor, though. Energy prices. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it went up. I think it went up about 12.8%.
Or a two-year period of time, it's gone down.
12-month period.
I'm just saying, over a 24-month period of time, it's gone down. So if you compared where energy prices are today to where they were on February 27th, 2015, certainly 14, they're lower.
But think they're looking the past year.
I understand that, but it's not like things went, it's not like there was pullback when the CPI might have, I guess my only concern is 3% is higher than we can raise taxes because of the silliness of Proposition 2.5. Unless I'm missing something.
It's, right. Our tax levy still will go up 2.5.
Right.
I'm still uncomfortable using that area. I can't believe we're in that Boston area. I know.
I'll pull the sheet for you.
There's other SMSA areas in the country and.
Another what in the country?
Standard metropolitan statistical areas.
I'm not sure if that's what they use.
And, well, there's that, or there's other regions that don't fall in the area. The government has, they adjust salaries based on conditions in the areas.
What department is that?
Well, it's Office of Management Budget, OMB, has different areas.
I don't think OMB, that's, it might be the CBO. I don't think it's OMB.
Well, whatever, but.
That's the White House.
I mean, I'm happy to look.
OPM. OPM. Office of Personnel Management, OPM.
That would be in DLS, right? Department of Labor Statistics.
Yeah.
I think so, which is.
Or Bureau of Labor Statistics.
Because, like I say, Social Security has never gone up 3%. I mean.
Well, it has some years.
Not the last four or five years. The total hasn't gone up 3%.
Okay, well, Brian's going to look into it. Okay.
And I think people are going to complain that, you know.
Can I ask a question? Why is the heavy equipment operator getting a remarkably smaller increase than everybody else?
This was based on the salary survey from the Collins Center. So what the personnel committee does, and what they've done as a practice, I'm told, is that they try to bring positions that are 3% below the actual median up to above 3% the actual median.
For like-sized towns.
You realize that's a vicious cycle.
There's seven.
Because the minute we go up, that means the median changed. Yeah. And well, then somebody fine. Else. And
yes. Yes, I'm aware
of that. I'm not saying they don't deserve the money. I'm just saying that it's a vicious cycle. But it's just interesting, the equipment operator foreman went up 9 cents an hour. Mm-hmm. And everyone else went up at least 43 cents an hour. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The foreman was a Keith's request. It wasn't even recommended, I don't think, by the budget. He just wanted to separate the equipment operator. He wanted to have a bigger separation to the foreman.
I thought that was under, no?
But it's still 9 cents as opposed to, at least the library associate is going up 55 cents. The custodian's going up 43 cents.
Yeah, those are just way under. That's why.
Right. I mean, the police sergeant's going up over two. And I'm not saying, I don't have a beef with it. It's just like, it's very disproportionate.
Which heavy equipment operator is not 39 cents?
No, 2056 to 2075.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. 19 cents.
Or 19 cents.
Still smaller than everybody else by a lot. Yeah. Percentage-wise.
Yeah.
Right. But again, it wasn't even recommended to go up. Keith requested it go up so he could have some separation in his department. All the rest were recommended by the survey.
Right.
As okay. being grossly underpaid.
Okay.
So it would be this rate plus the 3%? Or does that include these include the 3%?
Does not include 3%.
Does not, okay. So 3% would be another 6 cents.
And it's 3% on the original hourly rate, not the new hourly rate.
3% on the new hourly rate.
Yeah, why not the old hourly rate?
3% the old hourly rate? Because,
you're getting a 3% increase.
The idea is that the 3% is an adjustment for inflation.
I get that, but it should be based upon the original salary, not the new salary.
Why is that?
Just seems like it's common sense to me. I'm adjusting my inflation based upon. Okay, I get what I'm saying. Doesn't make sense, but Okay. Again, it's not a lot of money. These guys deserve every penny of it, but.
We're making an adjustment, given that we had the Collins Center do all this. You know, we asked them, and they did. They produced what they think we should be paying people. So we're going to move forward with an adjusted salary plus a COLA.
Okay.
And is there a figure somewhere that will tell us the impact on the budget?
Yep.
Of all of this? Okay.
Yep. We have a meeting on Wednesday night, right?
Yep.
Is this going to be discussed?
Yeah.
Yep, I believe so. We put it on Wednesday or we put it on the 8th?
No, this Wednesday.
Wednesday, right?
Okay, we've got updates. Maybe not.
Okay. How many do you want?
How many?
I like maybe not.
Yeah, we don't really need updates.
How about?
I feel pretty caught up.
How about just one? I did get in touch with Vern from Thayer Street Associates.
Oh, good.
He did have a structural engineer take a look at that garage.
Yeah.
He's going to see if his recommendation changes at all by the pictures of the foundation.
Good.
Corroding away. But one of the things that he did say was, in terms of raising the building, it's not anything that would be recommended to fit taller dump trucks. Something about the how it was built and it can't handle wind shear up higher, would it be safe because they didn't put any supports up through the blocks when it was put, when the building was built.
Well, so, I would imagine it depends how high you raise the roof, right?
It would, yeah.
But wasn't that,
I didn't think we were still considering raising the roof.
Well, I thought that was a dead issue, yeah.
No, it is a dead issue.
Yeah. Didn't he say that 6 months ago or whatever?
At least.
I think that, yeah. He's supposed to be getting a summary.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he's given a summary.
He's seen that before, okay.
Yeah.
But the thing he's got to be aware of when he's looking at the pictures, that's only one
iteration. Yeah.
I mean, yeah. Maybe the worst case scenario, but you can't assume the other 8 locations are just like that either.
Right.
So.
This isn't a final opinion from him. This is what the
engineer... Well, we know the building's in awful shape.
Right. And Keith and I are going to be with him in the early part of March. Well, probably mid-March.
With Vern or with the structural engineer?
Both. And talk about the building a little bit more. Pay a visit to the center school as well.
Can you wait until the second week of March?
Sure. I mean, yeah.
I, as the liaison, I wouldn't mind being a part of that meeting.
Well, they could maybe have some more foundation exposed by then, too.
I think we're talking tentatively the... I think we said the 16th. 17th. It's not set yet because
school break.
His engineer's not back yet, so we couldn't set a final date.
Could we do like <clears throat> 8:00 in the morning?
On the 16th?
Like 8:05?
I can check, sure. Yeah, we'll coordinate by email. I'll put you on the email list.
Yeah.
So we coordinate a date. And nothing set in stone, but that's what we were thinking would work.
Now, is this for just a discussion, or are you planning on physically looking at some points in the foundation?
Wrong month.
I don't know yet. They're going to take a look at the pictures first, and then may do some additional exploring as needed.
I take that back. Early afternoon, like 12:30.
You'll be on the email list.
Or one. Okay.
You guys can work it out.
Yep.
Is there a cost to this?
Sure. I mean, if we need to go into details, or we need him to come up with a solution for at least stabilizing the building, then obviously we would have cost for something.
No, but I mean cost, his cost.
To meet with him?
Yes.
Nothing. So that building was just built with concrete blocks with no reinforcement.
That's the way I understand it.
With no stem wall.
No,
it's just footing.
Yeah, but nothing inside.
What year was
blocks,
it built?
The cells.
No.
62,
63.
Yeah.
No Z bar, no Z bar. Well.
And then, one other thing. Just so folks know, there is a application for the construction of a cell tower at 84 Haydenville Road. That's going to be going in front of the Zoning Board of Appeals and Planning Board.
Where's 84?
84.
It's not that far up.
It's up beyond the stones. Do you know where?
Oh, beyond the stones.
Yeah. Well, it's up the hill beyond.
Because there's no cell coverage up there, so.
It's almost out.
Telling me.
It's almost to the town line.
Yeah, I'm probably still not going to get
over by the reservoir.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's really? Just on the edge.
I never remember the guy's name. There's a house up there.
Yeah, he's going on private. Here he is.
And the cell tower is how many feet above the tree line?
100 feet total.
Well, it's 100 feet total, so let's say the tree is 70?
Yeah, that's about.
So 30?
Okay, so 30, can we have branches put on the cell tower?
How about painted green?
They were supposed to float balloons.
They did.
They were supposed to float a balloon this past weekend.
I drove up and it was foggy as could be, so I
did. They did it on Sunday.
Sunday, thanks.
Okay, when's that hearing?
So, I want to say it's this week, but it's on the website if people are interested.
I think ZBA is meeting Thursday.
Requires a special permit from the Zoning Board of Appeals.
What's the revenue kick to the town of Whately for this?
Good question.
It'll just be personal
property taxes. Obviously, we don't own the property.
That's unfortunate.
We'll have to see what the other one gets.
So landowner is getting some money.
The landowner is the leaseholder.
Good deal for the landowner.
The lessor.
He could use it.
Okay.
So we got anything else, or is that it?
I think that could be enough.
Okay.
Motion.
Sorry. What else we decided? This is. Sorry.
We're down here.
Yeah.
What is this?
This is the form for the NEC APCO 1 license that was granted. Previous meeting. We didn't sign it.
We talked earlier about the farm office space. Jonathan wasn't here. We were going to ask him about Skims. What's the latest on Skims?
Oh, yeah.
What's happening?
John, any Skims?
Only that the town of Deerfield is moving forward with construction of an ambulance, a place to house the ambulances. A formal vote hasn't been taken. However,
by who?
By the Skims Board of Oversight.
Okay.
But
Do they matter anymore?
It doesn't really matter that much because they're going to build that. We've been told that it will be built regardless.
Are they using prevailing wage?
There was an opinion that was provided by the Department of Labor Standards that said it needed to, and then when it got. What's the term I'm looking for? What's the term Brian used? Alternative facts.
I chose a Trump term for you.
Alternative facts.
Alternative facts.
That's Kellyanne Conway.
If there is no involvement from any public officials.
It's already happened.
My only question to Brian is if it goes forward and we move in, are we, and someone contests it, are we then subject to the penalty?
The town of Whately?
Yes, because we are could we be viewed as a party to violation that we knowingly, that we know, even with this, we have an opinion, so, but we also know that the opinion is based on facts that aren't reality.
Yeah.
So are we subject to the penalty?
What would they be contesting?
Somebody, if a building is built without using prevailing wage.
A public building.
A public building. And someone, and it's a bidding process, obviously. Or no, it doesn't even have to be a bidding process. And someone says, no, it should have been built by prevailing wage. Okay. They can contest that, and there will be damages awarded to, is that right, Brian?
There's fines.
There's fines.
I assume Skim's board knows that.
I have driven that point home to Skim's many, many, many times. Okay. But there are people who don't agree with that opinion because now the most recent Department of Labor standards has said, as long as no public involvement. But I just don't understand. I don't think anyone on the Deer, you know, maybe Deerfield's going to hire someone who's an expert in building an ambulance facility, and that, if that's the case, that's fine. But I think the water's over the dam already in terms of public input on what this thing's going to look like. But are we subject to the penalties? We got to know that because it is alternative facts.
Do we have to vote this or tell me? I'm sorry, Brian.
Yeah, hold on one second. My answer to what Jonathan was a convoluted one, in the sense that it's not really clear. To me, and I think this may come out in a report that's going to be coming out from Joe Markarian on behalf of Sunderland about what's the legal status of Skems. If Skems is a department of Deerfield, then I don't see any liability for the town in terms of prevailing wage if it was a fine. If it was, I don't know what else or entity Skems could be in the legal sense. It's not a fund, it's not a nonprofit, it's not a, I don't know what it is. It's not a quasi-public organization or agency that was created by special legislation. It's an agreement between three towns to operate an ambulance service. So if we have more clarity on that, then it's an easier question to answer.
And my only counter to that, and I totally understand that.
Yeah.
But right now we are subject to civil litigation against us for an action that has been taken by the South Deerfield Fire District or the town of Deerfield, I'm not sure.
Town of Deerfield, there's a fiscal agent.
And Skems for not hiring, for discrimination. So if we are subject to a suit by an individual claiming we are party to it, how is that different than?
Well, we'll have to see how that plays out because you can be sued. The question is, and I believe it's one of the issues. It's an NCAD discrimination claim.
Right.
Is whether the town of Whately is an appropriate party to be included in the lawsuit.
But if it's found that it is, then that's a whole different category.
Then that informs our answer as to
on Skems.
It's a discrimination because we're discriminating against workers.
Failure to hire based upon, we don't want to talk too much about it, but it's a failure to hire claim.
Okay.
And it was termination back in 2010 by the town of Deerfield / South Deerfield Fire District.
That part, I don't recall.
I could be wrong about. I mean, but there's something. Was employed, was no longer employed, or was no longer getting regular shifts.
I think that's.
Oh. Okay.
I think that's.
Yeah.
In terms of Skems in the town of Whately, it was failure to hire when Skems was created.
Right. But the failure to hire was based on the previous actions that had been taken.
Okay, we just wanted an update on Skems. I think we got it.
Yeah, I mean, it's moving forward. I think it's going to be what it is, and we I have been, I mean, our hands are tied. There's not a lot we
can do. My concern for bringing this up before you got here was we have space. We should rent it out.
Oh, yeah, we should rent it out.
We should get some revenues coming in.
I've told people at Skems that Whately is no longer interested in renting our building to Skems.
Did we say that?
Before me as a board?
Yeah.
No, but I, no. But I'm, it's, I didn't say that we voted on it, I said that.
Oh, this is getting a little semantical here.
Do we need to vote at town meeting to move to the new building?
That's a good question, Dan, and I've thought about that a lot. It's on the same footprint. The question is, it's more of the question, do we need to vote to move from Sunderland and Whately?
Yep.
The secondary and tertiary right. ambulance.
And adjust the rent accordingly.
Right, and that is that a question of town meeting or not? And Brian, I don't know whether you have any information on that or not. But.
I would think it is, but
it's a question of whether you define that as moving
the IMA
facility or
does not define what is substantial changes. So right. you could argue it is, and I could argue it's not, and we'd probably both be right, or both be wrong.
We just don't want to pay someone an extra $12,000.
But doesn't the town have to vote on moving the location?
But there's a discrepancy as to whether it is truly moving or not, because it's the same footprint. It's literally next door.
They're adjacent to
where it's housed right okay. now. So then that's going to be a matter, that's going to be very subjective. And of right. course, you know, the IMA would never want to be anything more than nebulous.
The term in the IMA is substantial changes required.
Well, the
approval at three town meetings. So what's substantial change?
The 36,000 will no longer go to the fire district.
Right. It'll go to the town of Deerfield.
Two separate entities.
Can I bring up something else? I'm reading in the paper the senior center, South County Senior Center.
Yep.
There's an article that they're looking at moving into the church, but anyway, for the, and I don't know whether it's for the center, I think Deerfield appointed three people from the town to look into either remodeling the church or making the South County Senior Center useful for senior living. Isn't Whately part of that? South County?
We are part of the operations of the South County Senior Center. We are not part of the facility of the South County Senior Center. We do share in some of the basic maintenance costs, but the town of Deerfield covers all structural maintenance.
Okay.
So if the town of Deerfield decided to move where it's providing the housing for South County
yeah.
Senior Center to the church,
right.
and it's a better location,
right. okay.
Then so be it.
But who decides on the cost of that?
Well, that they would have to come to the other towns. I mean, they have to ask us to be a part of that cost sharing, otherwise they can't. I mean, they can't just unilaterally make decisions for us based upon.
But they've appointed three people from Deerfield to look into it. And I'm not sure whether it's the old or the new. And my concern is, shouldn't Whately be part of that? Only
if they're going to ask us to share in the cost of renovation.
Well, I assume there's cost of renovation. They talk about.
But if the town of Deerfield were to incur that entire cost. Doesn't matter to us. If they
You're
want
talking about the church, right? Church,
yeah,
right.
the congregational church.
Yeah.
If they want us to help share in that cost, in that renovation cost, then they need to come to us. But they haven't indicated that that's going to be an issue yet.
Okay. And on the existing location, do we share the cost now?
Only of things like if the oven breaks.
Okay.
Like a tenant,
cost.
Essentially.
Not an
like a tenant.
Like a tenant that doesn't have to carry any of the maintenance costs or any of the structural maintenance costs.
Right. Electricity and whatever all that
yeah.
provided. Okay.
All right. So, motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Okay.
Second. We're good.